My name is Greta Scharnweber, and I'm the Associate Director of the Hagop Kevorkian Center for Near Eastern Studies here at NYU. And it's my pleasure to welcome all of you on behalf of the Kevorkian, but also on behalf of all of our collaborators this evening, which include the Center for Religion and Media, the Center for Media, Culture, and History, and of course, NYU Abu Dhabi. And this is part of an ongoing series on digital religion, knowledge, politics, and practice, which receives generous funding from the Henry R. Luce Initiative on Religion and International Affairs. There are a few individuals I'd like to thank by name, and as is our practice, this is such a wonderful collaboration that we have going among our centers. Specifically, Angela Zito, Faye Ginsburg, the co-directors of the Center for Media or Center for Religion and Media, Peggy Vale of the Center for Media, Culture, and History, Carrie Barrett of NYU Abu Dhabi, and Anne Naumann of the Center for Religion and Media. And I'd also like to thank Toby Volkman, our program officer at the Luce Initiative, who's here with us this evening. So this evening we're going to be speaking about Tahrir Square 2012. And of course we've all been watching with great interest the events in Egypt as they've been unfolding over the past several months, over a year now. We've been bringing together journalists with academics, filmmakers, and other scholars to think about the role of media in social events around the world, in the Middle East in particular. And tonight we're focusing on Egypt. And of particular relevance, we feel, are often unheard voices of women and religious minorities. But in fact, these voices have been covered in the media, but perhaps in incomplete ways. And so we've asked the panelists this evening to unpack some of those voices and discuss the ways in which their work has overlapped with the concerns of these groups and others that perhaps don't appear in the title, but will be discussed tonight. And let me begin with one sad announcement, which is earlier versions of advertising for this panel included Mona El-Tahawi, who is a journalist and blogger and someone who's really been visible in the discourse around what's happening in Egypt. She unfortunately can't be with us tonight, but it is for a very important reason. Some of you may have read the coverage of her sexual assault, which happened in Egypt several months ago now, but she's in the process of suing the Egyptian government for the activities that surrounded that assault, and she's meeting with her human rights lawyers about her case in Egypt presently, and so she wasn't able to be with us here tonight. But let's not let that detract from who is here, and we're very lucky to have two presenters who've come all the way from far around the globe, from Egypt. And we have with us Viola Shafik and Yasmin Moll. And I will let our moderator introduce them, but let me introduce her. Dina Ramadan is assistant professor of Arabic at Bard College. She is a senior editor of Arab Studies Journal and a founding member and secretary of the Association for Modern and Contemporary Art of the Arab World, Iran, and Turkey. Her research has focused on the development of the category of modern art in early 20th century Egypt and the intersection between the discourses on education and the role of artistic production. She is currently working on a project that traces the transformation of the role of the artist vis-a-vis revolutions in modern Egyptian history. She has been published in Art Journal, Arab Studies Journal, Journal of Visual Culture, and the Mesa Bulletin. And she also has a chapter forthcoming in a volume on African art history that examines the relationship between fatwas and the fine arts in Egypt. And she will get the conversation started after the panelists present, and we also have a variety of media to show to you tonight.
Introducing our speakers and then opening the floor up to discussions once they've presented. So to my far left is Dr. Viola Shafik, who is a freelance filmmaker, film curator, and film scholar. She's the author of Arab Cinema, History and Cultural Identity, and Popular Egyptian Cinema, Gender, Class, and Nation. She's published numerous articles and studies, primarily on Arab cinema and culture, as well as on transnational film. She's lectured at the American University in Cairo and has cooperated with national and international film festivals. She's a consultant for the Al-Rawi Screenwriters Lab and the Venice Film Biennale, as well as a member of the selection committee of the World Cinema Fund and the Dubai Film Connection. She directed experimental short films and documentaries, among them The Lemon Tree in 1993, The Planting of Girls in 1999, Journey of a Queen in 2003-4, and most recently My Name is Not Ali in 2011. And to my immediate left is Yasmin Moll, who I'm sure many of you know because she's a student here in the PhD program in Anthropology at NYU. She's been in Cairo for the last 18 months conducting dissertation fieldwork with Islamic media producers and viewers with funding from the Fulbright Hayes, the SSRC, Werner Gram, NSF, and NYU. She's been blogging regularly about the revolution for AUC, transit, and the American Anthropological Association. Her video, Women of Tahrir, shot during the Egyptian Revolution, won the Best Video Award in the Common Ground, 1001 Stories competition, and the Jury Award at the 3-Minute Media Social Issue Film Festival in 2011. So if you'd like to join me in welcoming both of our speakers.
Thank you very much for this very nice invitation. I mean, it's really a pleasure to be back to New York, particularly because, you know, I was long time ago also a fellow at FACE Center, Center for Media, Culture and History, and it was a great pleasure to be here. And so for me, it's like a nice comeback to see you. And of course, I also feel very sad that Mona Tahawi could not come, because I think she would have been a major enrichment for this panel, particularly because also of the events that and the harassment, and you know also that she broke her both two arms, and so it's very tragic what happened to her, and actually also very telling about the situation through which we go, and so therefore it's a pity really that she is not there. Okay, so we decided, as we have some extra time, that we are going to start with a sort of teaser, which is a small a short film, a 7-minute short film. Unfortunately, for technical reasons, it does not have subtitles, but so we had to choose either subtitles or the sound, but I think the sound is nicer. So I will try, and you know, so allow me to improvise. I will not give the best translation, but you know, a kind of punctual translation, so that you will get the content as far as possible. The title of the film is Common Interest, and the reason why I show it is also because I was involved in the making of this film as a kind of supervisor producer. It was made, but I have to underline, it's a group work, so I'm happy to show it, but really as, you know, the product of a group, because it's part of a campaign that is called Make Up Your Mind, which was, you know, developed under the umbrella of the Al-Mayadeen Al-Tahriya Association, which is a German-Egyptian association with volunteers, and we had the idea after the revolution to, you know, campaign for democracy, and but with edutainment products, which means, you know, and we wanted to create entertaining formats. Films and leaflets and comic strips and so on, in order to, you know, reach regular people who could be interested in, you know, the product and watching it, by watching it, learning something about democracy. And actually, we are also, I mean, it's a project that does not want to be, you know, confined to the elite, and therefore we are using it, I mean, we use the channel of another campaign, which is called the Freedom Bus, which is a bus that tours through the provinces with volunteers, and through, you know, the personal encounter with people in the villages or in the provinces, these volunteers want to promote, you know, to give information, to empower the voters and, you know, the people, in order to be politically, to raise political awareness. And they are using our products for this campaign. And so this is the background of the film. And as the film talks about something that, is in a way related to what we are discussing today, we thought that it might be a nice introduction. If some people want to go to Imbaba, what can they do? Get me those customers. We want to have £1. You have to, because usually it's 75 piastres, but he's saying, telling the boy to get them for £1. This man's interest is to sit close to the window. Will cost £1. This boy's interest is to use cash. Yeah. Why is it £1? It's usually 75 piastres. You should not pay that much. I told you it's £1. I still need a quarter. This young man's interest is to prevent the driver from exploiting the people. You told us only after we came on the bus. Here's someone who doesn't want to pay. Who said that I'm going to leave? Relax. You are exploiting us. Come on, drive on. This woman's interest is to come, not to be late to her work. It's a matter of principles. Why should we be exploited? We don't want to have problems. This man's common interest is not to have problems. An important man who wants the bus to get away. A disguised beggar who wants the microbus to stay in order to get money. Why are you standing here? Take it easy. They don't want to pay. He wants £1. Solve your problems together. You should not stay here. A policeman whose interest is that the problem gets solved outside his area. We will all leave. No. this man's interest is that the beautiful girl leaves. No, you should stay. This man's interest is that the beautiful girl stays. You drive us back. Please, we are late. Will we now leave or will we go back? We will go back. We have interests. We need to leave. You know what? I have an exam today, but I will. We always, spend our time on little problems. Okay, I will not drive further. You can all leave. These people, these young people should be burned. They spoiled the country. There were people who wanted to, their interest was to go to Imbeba, but they never arrived there. It's one way, one interest, constitution for all, and the law above all. Okay, so this film made, first when it was launched on YouTube, it made like in 3 weeks almost 70,000 viewers, and then they exceeded the 100,000 meanwhile. And also, I mean, from the street, we know from the volunteers that people on the street were very eager to watch it. I mean, they kind of identified very much with it. I think because it expressed, and people liked it, I think because it expressed very much the feeling after, I mean, in the weeks, in the months after the revolution, particularly after when the first euphoria diminished. So, and this film was produced in summer. It was launched in July, August. So this was the time when the first peak already, you know, had went down. Okay, anyways, we can discuss this later. Then I would like to start with my presentation, given the I made it. I got it. So now if I find the PowerPoint, sure, I do. Hopefully. Yeah. Good. Okay. All right. So my talk is going to be about the marches of revolution. Is this an interreligious public? But first of all, let me just make a remark. I think in your program, you wrote that I'm a Coptic filmmaker, which is, I found it a kind of funny, you know, combination, religion and profession. But I need, unfortunately, to make a correction here because I'm not a Copt. because I was raised in a Protestant family, but there might be a possibility that it's still a correct description. If we look at the first point, Copt or Copti is derived from the Greek Egyptos, i.e. Egypt, so in that sense I'm still a Copt. Okay. Well, then let me continue. Well, who are the Copts? I need to give you a short description before we go more into the depths of the topic, because some of you may not know exactly what kind of minority this is. It's a Christian minority, but it's one of the oldest Christian communities in the world. They form around 8 to 12% of the population. But actually, it's not like in Lebanon, for example, that they are geographically or distinguished from, the other population, or that they are, there is also no linguistic difference actually between Christian and Muslims. The Coptic Orthodox Church of Alexandria is one of the Eastern Orthodox churches. Has the oldest catechetical school. It was the founder of monasticism. It is a distinct national church, and this is kind of important, since the Council of Chalcedon, 451 after the birth of Christ. And this is important in the sense that it's not just, it's a national church, and this is important in terms of what kind of identification Christians have in Egypt. They were, and this is also important to our topic, were persecuted first by the Romans, then by the Byzantine Eastern Empire. So the Copts speak about their history, they speak about the era of the martyrs, which starts in the second century and ends with the Muslim conquest, with the Islamic conquest in the seventh century. They have, of course, in numbers, they diminished. I mean, they used to be the majority of the country, and also they used to have their own language, which is Coptic. It's a mixture between ancient Egyptian and Greek. But it is said that until the early 20th century, there were still some families in Egypt speaking Coptic, but today it's mainly the language of the liturgy of the church. Now, if we try to understand the Copts in terms of what kind of, how to situate them today in modern Egypt, we can see that there is, because of historical reasons, a problem of citizenship, of participation. Some of the reasons are historically rooted. Until modernity, the system in Islamic countries was dominated by something which we call the Zimma system, which was later with the Ottomans described as the millet system, which is, Zimma is first of all a religion, and millet is, kind of, says almost the same, but in Turkish. The system means that the minorities, the Jewish and Christians, are protected under, the law of the Muslims. They are protected minorities because they are the people of the book. That means they adhere to heavenly religion. And the people of the book are only considered by Islam, are only three, which is Islam, Christianity, and the Jews. This system meant that, particularly the millet system meant that you are a community, and that you have a certain internal independence in terms of that you rule yourself in terms of personal status, laws, and also a certain part of the jurisdiction is, done, regulated inside of the community. Whereas, the state is more responsible for, for the general system. Since 1825 onwards, we can see the first steps towards equal citizenship, but of course it's a long way. This was the first time when Muhammad Ali, the then governor and viceroy of vice king of Egypt, started to conscript Copts. Then in the 1940s to 60s, we have first of all, here, very important event was the 1919 revolution, where we can situate actually the beginning of the idea of citizenship in the sense, and also of political participation, because at that time, with Egypt becoming a constitutional monarchy, there were parties, and so Jews and Christians were very active were part of the party system, and there was a multi-party system in Egypt, and so there was an affiliation, a possible affiliation apart from the community, from the religious community, and this is an important shift. That means, you know, that your affiliation exceeded your community, your religious community, and you became part of a larger state. Well, unfortunately, this development was again, jeopardized in the 1940s to 60s. First of all, we have the rise of Arab Muslim nationalism, and then the Palestine question, and the founding of the State of Israel was also an important obstacle, because after that, the national Egyptian body started to exclude the Jews. So some of them left voluntarily, others were expelled. And so this kind of caused a sort of the diversity that was there before. Suddenly you had only two. That means the Jews were, their numbers were diminished. And now you had only two. So it started to become kind of a binary system at first, with the whole unitary idea of Muslim and Arab nationalism in the background. And also another additional very important development was that Nasserism, it was considered a revolution on the one hand, but on the other hand, it was a dictatorship. That means, a curtailing of political participation. The multi-party system was abolished. You had only one party. And so during these decades, the community, the Coptic community, retreated again back into the religious community. That means by the 80s, since the 1970s, we have also the spread of Islamism, a series of confessional incidents, bombings, killings, vendettas, and this all, made the Coptic community retreat, go back to the confinements of the churches, and actually also the Pope became a sort of political representative of the whole community. And so, for that reason, for example, Joel Benin speaks of, Egypt today as a sort of neo-millet system. So the whole, the attempt to create modern citizenship failed to a certain extent, even though there was all the time, calling for it, and particularly since the 90s, we have a very strong also movement of Coptic and Muslim dialogue within society, with, activists calling actually for the active recovery of modern citizenship, with equal modern citizenship. Okay, now I'm putting this image here because, I wanted to start to point out the iconography of this unitary binary system of a national unity that was developed first of all in the 1919 revolution, because in the 1919 revolution you could see images of, you know, of priests together with Muslim sheikhs appearing and backing, you know, Egypt's, you know, fighting against British colonialism and asking for a national independence. And so this image, this iconographic image of, you know, the crescent and the cross was kind of is emblematic, and it's historical at the same time. And you can see here, as you see in the last in the image to your right side, that it was used again in the revolution on the Tahrir Square. So, but for me is the question, there is always this calling, this call for national unity. And national unity is always described as the unity of the cross and the crescent. Now, is it a binary image? I mean, is it in a way a diverse image, or is it rather a polarized image that, you know, is kind of endangered to become a kind of hotbed for separation and sectarianism? Well, now let's have a look at the Tahrir experience during the latest revolution. To me, as someone who was really present there, it's actually an experience that I can also, you know, say that many shared the same experience with me, so it's not just my personal experience, but I think it's a common experience, was that this place was an inclusive, the Tahrir squares, and we are speaking actually of plural squares, because there were other places, not only the Tahrir square, involved, that it's an inclusive agora. And there was a sense of mobilization, empowerment as a person, as a political subject also. And there was a sense of unity as Egyptians, but at the same time there was a strong awareness of differences, that you know, of diversity and positive differences. That means, you know, you could see, you know, people from the countryside. You could see rich people, Copts, evident Copts. You could see, you know, liberals, veiled women, unveiled women. Poor people, rich people, and they were all there, and they were all, you know, kind of united through this experience. Well, but this was the euphoria of that time, and it was an enriching experience, but it did not last. And as you all may know, the counter-revolution started almost immediately after the downfall of the president, on February 11, and you know, on March 8 already, we had the first crackdowns by the military police on demonstrators, and also other very serious events. And from here started again, you know, the issues of that we are separated and not just a unity. Now, what are the obstacles to equal citizenship with respect to the Copts? The constitution, actually, starting from the very first constitution that was created after the revolution in 1919, the Egyptian constitution states that there is equal citizenship. There is no difference in front of the law. Yet, religion is still indicated on the IDs. Laws are disregarded, police and jurisdiction are biased, these are the experiences, and most crimes against Copts, including manslaughter, never got penalized. The construction of churches needs, contrary to mosques, extra licensing and is monitored by state security, who often obstruct, actually, and prevent the licensing for several reasons. Many of the incidents on which we are going to talk later are actually have been involving churches whose legal status was still pending. You know, the file was with the state security, and these were some of the churches that got attacked and burned. So it is therefore suspected that authorities have an indirect hand in some of the assaults, and this for political reasons. Okay, now I wanted to very quickly to summarize the incidents that involved Copts, confessional incidents that involved Copts after the revolution, because actually during the revolution there was not a single confessional incident. You know, no one was attacked. There was no problem, even though the police was completely absent, security was completely absent from the streets. But one important event was January 1, the bombing of the Saint Church in Alexandria, and this was actually a kind of prelude to the revolution, because this week after, from January 1 to 6, was already a very active week with people going to the streets and doing demonstrations and so on. So already this event was very important also to mobilize people to be ready to go to the streets later on, because people were actually shocked about this bombing. And as we learned later, is that the Ministry of Interior most probably has a hand in it, which is even more shocking. Okay, so now let's have a very quick review on what were the assaults on Copts after the revolution. We have March 4, the destruction of a church in the village of Sol at Fir Helouan. This is close to Cairo. On March 6, Coptic sit-in at Maspiro. This is the radio and television building, radio and television union building. I will show you an image later. And on March 8, we have a Salafi demonstration at Tahrir demanding the release of Camilia, a convert allegedly detained in a monastery. This is an incident which is kind of weird, because Camilia's story was 6, 7, 8 months old. So why on that particular day, on March 8, Salafis, which means the ultra-Islamists, why do they come out and have a demonstration on the Tahrir Square? See at the date on March 9, we have very important military crackdown on protesters at the Tahrir Square, because there were still protesters camping on Tahrir Square, and there was, at that very day, there was a crackdown on them, and at the same time, there was an assault on Copts in the Mokattam, which is, close to, it's just outskirts of Cairo. Rumors were in the streets that Copts are burning a mosque. And so people from a close by neighborhood rushed to Al-Mukattam, and there was a clash and several people killed. So we don't think that this is an accident, that this happened accidentally. We all think that there is a sort of correlation between all the three events, because the moment you want to have a crackdown on the place, the Tahrir Square, where that symbolizes the unity, you use a confessional, you use the Copts as as a way to distract from the protests. And you go back to divide and rule policy. Okay, on May 7, Salafi mob storms a church in Cairo neighborhood, where alleged under the pretext that they were hiding weapons and female converts. On October, several dead. Also, October 1, destruction of an allegedly illegal church in a village near Aswan. And this was, October 6, violent beating of demonstrators at Maspiro by military police. On October 9, crackdown on peaceful Coptic demonstration heading for Maspiro. 28 shot or run over by army vehicles, and you probably saw this on the news. And the latest incident in February 2012, expulsion of 8 Coptic families from a village in Amreya, which is a sort of beginning of ethnic cleansing. Okay. There is a Coptic controversy about Tahrir or Maspiro. Maspero, this is the Maspero building. This is the RTU building. Interestingly, as we saw in the timeline here on March 4th, the moment the first heavy attack on Copts, the Copts choose to make a sit-in, not on the Tahrir Square, but in front of the RTU building. Why? We have at the same time foundation of a so-called association of Coptic youth. And they are the ones who call for these sit-ins and for the demonstrations. And they are, one of the leaders of this group is the priest Philopatia, who is here seen in one of the images. And actually there was a controversy because some of the Coptic activists who are the liberals were asking why, were trying to convince the youth not to make a sit-in in front of Maspero, but rather to go and to do it on Tahrir. But the priests were against that. They said, no, we want to have our own sit-in. And this, of course, was this opened the way for the massacre. Because then it was quite easy, you know, they excluded themselves from the Tahrir, and then therefore it was easier to, you know, to crack down on them. Okay, I will try to show you a very small image of the a small clip from the events on Maspero. This is a Christian channel on the internet that shows these events. Now, at the same time, and this is interesting now in terms of media, at the same time, this incident happened around 6:30 in the evening. This was the news, news at the same time. This was around 7 o'clock in front of us she is speaking from within the same building that where the, all these events were going on. And she said, you know, that the content of this speech was very, it was very, it was, do you want to hear it? She's kind of polemizing. It's a polemic speech. What happens to Egypt? Three martyrs and 20 people wounded, all of them from the army. It's not by Israelis or by enemies, but it's from the people of, from our own people. This army, it's the one who backed the revolution and was against that that anyone gets shot from the Egyptian people. But today, people are shooting at the army. What's that group? Whatever they want, whoever, how can they burn a whole homeland? Where are the wise men of this nation who have been talking about unity?
هذه الأسماء؟ أين هم الآن؟
Where are they now?
أين هم الآن لنسمع صوت العقل؟ لنسمع صوت التروي؟ هل أصبح
We want the voice of reason.
كان يؤيد الثورة.
Those who have been with the revolution and have now their personal interests, how can they make this assault on the homeland? We endured a lot, and we have to sacrifice for the nation. The Coptic demonstrators have been shooting at them, and they are throwing stones at the army, at the soldiers, with Molotov cocktails. Security and military are trying to control the situation. And they are trying to secure that no one gets into the Maspero building. Okay, this was in it was in a talk show. They showed it again in a talk show. So what's important here? Why am I showing you? These are different, angles on the same event. At the same time, she was speaking, and the images that you see are actually after the whole event has been over, and after the tanks have run over many people. So it's also, kind of a very organized event, and it's propaganda, evidently. Now, a third... these are two angles of the same of two angles. I'll show you a third angle. It's from an Islamic source. It's a source that I got all of it from from the net. And this source is an Islamic one. It shows the priest Philopatea that you saw earlier, who is calling, that's the day before, he is calling for a demonstration that Egypt has never seen before. We will make a demonstration that no one saw before. It will end in Maspero. Many liberals and the movement of 6 April will be present, and I'm telling you something very important. We will not get our rights without the Muslims who are I did not understand this completely. Don't think that we are a minority. We are the majority. As real Copts, the intruders are the minority who wants to bring us back to who wants to send us back to backwardness. We are the majority. Raise your head, you are a Copt. Raise your head. And this is actually, a kind of aberration of the slogan that was on the Tahrir Square, which was raise your head, you are Egyptian. In this case, it's and now it's a source that was presenting this as, you know, the kind of demagogy of a priest inciting people to go to the Maspero, and it was shown, you know, as it was actually used against him, and similar images were actually used also by the military in order to underline that there was a conspiracy and that the Copts, particularly these priests, were involved in organizing this Maspero attack against the soldiers, which is not true. You know, we know later, of course, we understood that it's not true. Okay, so all this material is available on the internet, and circulating through different. No, I'm not getting it. Sorry. Yeah, no. Okay, now there is a second question related to that. Is Maspero the resurgence of, does it present the resurgence of a Coptic martyr's ideal? Because this ideal was actually already very. It came to the front already in the 90s, where, you know, the Coptic priests and people in the church started speaking about the new era of martyrdom. And this, because of the events that happened, you know, in the 90s, the assaults on Copts and, you know, the increased number of incidents. And what you see here are the images. They are also on the internet, on different Facebook sites and so on, that are, they represent the marches of the bombing of the church in Alexandria before the revolution. And actually, the concept of martyrdom is pretty similar in the Muslim belief, as well as in the one used by the Christians. And even when you see, you know, I try to research different sources, they use also similar, you know, the content, you find it pretty similar. And all of them actually kind of promise the paradise to those who die for the, you know, for the sake of the nation or the faith or the community. Now the question is: do the marches, can they? Do they represent, you know, a common ground, or is it again a new reason for separatism? The marches are very important. Are still for the revolution. You can see here the subway. There is, you know, it was taken. This image was taken two or three days after the demise of the stepping down of Mubarak. You can see that people stepped. People erased the name of Mubarak and put the name the marches. Maspero, we have the advent of common martyrs. Mina Daniel is one of them. He is a 19 years old who was killed at Maspero, and he was here. You see in one of him in that image there. You can see him camping. Oops. Okay. Camping on the Tahrir Square. And this is his sister. Now, in the following months, since October till now, Mina Daniel was circulating on many different media. One, you know, you can see him here on the subway as a graffiti. You can see him, you know, as a graphic and also as a mask used, you know, and the slogan was like in the case of Khaled Said, who was, you know, the blogger who was killed by the police, with the slogan, "We are all Mina Daniel and we are all Khaled Said," which means, you know, a form of solidarity. You can see here also, you know, an image that was circulating on the internet, the mother, two mothers of Khaled Said, the blogger, and of the mother of Mina Daniel. And then here we can see, you know, a cartoon by Carlos Latouf, the Brazilian caricaturist, who has This appeared in February, the lower one, with Khalid Said, you know, Khalid Said and Mubarak, and there you can see this one appeared after the death of Mina Daniel. And some people on Facebook actually use both of them together. You have it as, you know, used as an sort of iconographic image. There is also, in the clashes in Mohammed Mahmoud Street, there is the Mina Daniel flag that you see here. There is first cross and crescent, and then you see, you know, the image of Mina Daniel on the red, on that. And this, there are activists who, you know, they never stopped using this flag. It was used all the time on the street, and they, you know, shifts. They had shifts, but the most important issue was never to. And this is recently, you know, after the last clashes, after the Port Said massacre, you had this again. Now, my last question is, the existence of a martyr like Mina Daniel, who is used again, as you know, to form this binary unitarian image of the nation, but, you know, we can see that it's also a matter of circulation. What media, in which circuits are they represented? Here, for example, I can show you, this example is, you know, there are two statues that were used on the 25th of January with the names of the marchers on it. To work against the grain of the official media and of the propaganda we have, and Yasmin is going to talk about this initiative, Kazibun, which is Liars. It's a people's journalism initiative that uses, you know, that uses projections in the provinces, but also in Cairo, to show, you know, to discredit, or to show images that give a different notion and give a different view on the events, on the killings, on the assaults than the official media do. And here you can see it was projected on the Maspero building itself, which I find really a beautiful image. Okay, so the question which I see is still not resolved, even you see the attempt to create a common, you know, common iconography, common and a common view, and at the same time there are also forces and the circuits are also apart. So we will see in the coming time whether these different realities will, you know, if they have converging points or not. Thank you so much.
To start my presentation, I just want to show a short video that I made, that I shot during the 18-day uprising on my little flip camera, and then I posted online. And the video was meant to be a sort of it was something very simple, really, like a visual critique of Orientalist images of Muslim women as oppressed, disempowered, or voiceless.
الناس مش رايقة تاكل، الناس مش رايقة تتعامل مع يلا في ايه تاني بعد كده؟ تقعدوا لغايه ما يرحل
The aerial shot of Tahrir Square has become iconic of the Egyptian revolution, with the physical space of Tahrir a metonym for it. This image speaks of a nation united, of millions of people coming together with the common aim of overthrowing a corrupt dictatorship. On the first anniversary of January 25th, a few weeks ago, millions again converged on Tahrir Square, and again the image resurfaces, history replaying itself, it seems. This image does not describe revolutionary Egypt. Rather, it performs it. It seeks to ally the multifaceted contradictions, incoherences, and divisions that marked Tahrir Square on January 25, 2012, a celebration for some, a protest for others, and that continue to define the ongoing revolutionary process in Egypt as a whole. Such images of national unity, of a utopian Tahrir, work at once to romanticize the revolution, as well as, I think, actually neutralize its power to affect change by presenting an overgeneralized, underanalyzed version of events. Revolutionary images have been appropriated by pro-democracy activists, state media, private media, pop stars, charity organizations, filmmakers, Islamic preachers, bloggers, talk show hosts, poets, and multinational corporations such as Vodafone and Coca-Cola. They have been made into music videos. They have been made into corporate ads. They have been made into public service ads. They have been made into memorials, and they have been made into satire. Their variegated afterlife, however differently articulated and made material, seeks to transcend the current very real divisions in Egypt by hearkening back to this utopian moment of people power and mass unity where the unimaginable became real. And I myself sort of drew upon and contributed to digital economy in the video you just saw, which I shot of women protesters during Tahrir. And the idea for my talk today comes out of first, my experience in making this video, and second, and more importantly, my subsequent encounters with the competing image regimes that are both defining and mediating the current divisions in Egypt. In making the video, I had this idea that moving images could be used to move people to see differently, act differently, feel differently. And this idea came out of both my experience during the revolution and many of the people I spoke to who were sort of galvanized to action during those 18 days through viewing images. I myself decided to join the protest on January 28th, the Friday of Anger, after spending the previous 2 days on YouTube streaming dozens of videos uploaded by users in Egypt. And what I saw literally moved me, first to tears, and then to the street. And my embodied reaction to the revolution's emergent imagery wasn't really unusual or unique. Watching with family and friends different videos of the protests on YouTube, bodily responses would be invariably elicited. People would avert their eyes, or gasp, or clap, hug each other, start crying. And in a blog, I wrote then that this bodily engagement with film is a testament of the medium's unique ability to move us viscerally. And this is sort of where the power of the January 25th revolution and its images lies, in this capacity to move ordinary people to action. But the story images, including my own, purport to tell, the effects we imagine them to have, is much more complex than that. Sometimes images don't move at all, or don't move in the ways we want or expect them to. So what I'm interested in discussing today is not so much why images don't move others, a question that I think is both too ambitious and too narrow, but rather the movement of images themselves, what they do in circulation. Here I'm inspired by W.J.T. Mitchell's call to look not at the social construction of visuality, but rather the visual performance of the social field. Egyptians have been using images to perform certain kinds of work in the world, to call forth certain affective dispositions, emotions, actions, and to make others less possible, less sensible, less potent. So the subtitle of my presentation is The Visual Politics of the Egyptian Revolution. By visual politics, I mean the ways in which processes of image making, image viewing, and image circulation, along with the mediums that make them possible, whether online or offline, have become arenas of political critique and contestations. Egyptians at this time find themselves negotiating very different and competing image regimes, regimes which seek to define not only who gets to speak for Egypt and on what basis, but who should be counted as a revolutionary and who should not or cannot. So one of the aims of my presentation today is sort of to highlight the multifaceted nature of the politics of visuality in revolutionary Egypt and to think about some of the questions that arise at the intersections of media activism and image. So to that end, I will look at a video activist campaign that started in response to SCAF, which is the acronym for the Supreme Council of Armed Forces, in response to their violence in November and December against protesters, in particular the incident of the so-called blue bra girl. In Arabic, she's actually known as al-Fateh al-Mas'hula, or the girl who was dragged. The image of this woman being attacked and stripped by military officers sparked both international condemnation as well as a mass demonstration by thousands of Egyptian women, the most heavily attended and publicized protest by women, not only since Mubarak resigned, but according to some accounts, since the 1919 nationalist movement, who took to the streets claiming, chanting that Egypt's women are a red line. At the same time, this image also sparked a nationwide debate about its authenticity, a debate which often morphed into wider discussions about the kinds of public actions appropriate to both authentic revolutionaries and authentic Egyptian women. For example, I attended a public seminar by one of the Islamic televangelists that I'm researching for my dissertation, Mu'izz Mas'ud, the clean-shaven man, where he undertook a frame-by-frame analysis of the blue bra girl video with the intent of showing how the head of SCAF, Field Marshal Tantawi's claim to Jimmy Carter had come to Egypt and did this report, and Tantawi claimed that the video was fabricated, and Mu'izz wanted to show how, you know, if you look at it, you can't say that. And he later made the same analysis on his TV program, calling the blue bra girl the very embodiment of Egypt's honor, Sharaf Masr, and her attackers, Egypt's shame, Al Masr. On the other hand, Salafi preachers such as Muhammad Hassan on their Islamic channels have broadcasted a similar frame-by-frame analysis, but with a very different conclusion. And they take issue with the widespread sort of media description of this girl as a munakaba, or a woman who wears a face veil, which is an item of clothing tightly associated with the Salafi trend in Egypt. They say real Muslim women don't engage in these shameful actions precisely because they have honor. So as we will see, this sort of gendering of political activism and its framing in terms of normative notions of cultural authenticity and national belonging is key to the social life of revolutionary images. So in any case, the video activist campaign that I would like to discuss that began in the wake of military violence against protesters in November and December calls itself Askar Kezibun, or Lying Generals. I'll also take a look at the different groups which have sprung up to support SCAF and to counter groups such as Kezibun. There's actually a group on Facebook called Askar Saldikun, or Truthful Generals, and another called Know Your Enemy. And both have adopted the same media strategy as Kezibun, but with a very different aim. Indeed, as much as the incident of the blue bra girl shows us, much of these contestations take the form of images presented by both sides as evidence for a certain kind of political reality that others may not see or are choosing not to see, as sort of pixelated facts that brook no argument. But I would like to show a short excerpt from a news program where the presenter, Dina Abdulrahman, and an army general look together at a set of images and see very different things.
القوات المسلحة دي من نسيج الشعب المصري طبعاً ومن أبناء الشعب المصري
طبعاً
ولا يمكن واحد يعمل الكلام اللي سياسي بتقوله ده أو أي حد بيفكر فيه لو هتشوفي حتى لو لابس ميل يبقى مش من القوات المسلحة القوات المسلحة تتنصل منها
يعني معنى كده اللي شفناهم بيضربوا أو بيسحلوا أو بيتبولوا
لا
بيستخدموا أسلحة نارية مش من القوات المسلحة
أو الأفلام اللي بتتشاب دي انت بتشوف النتيجه لكن ما شفتش السبب هي بتتشدد بتتشدد ايه؟
بص حضرتك في مسدس هنا في ايد
المسدس اللي في ايده ده تسليح شرطي
تسليح
شرطي القران ولا كل صفات القوات المسلحه دلوقتي بينزلوا المسدسات بينزل انا ولا نازل ملكي اي ضابط في وحده عسكريه بينزل بالسلاح التسليح الشخصي
احنا ما بنتكلمش على التسليح الشخصي
لما تبقى هل استخدم
بص حضرتك استخدم اهو لو في واحد مستخدم كدرع بشري واجب يتم اطلاق رصاص من وراه
يا سيدتي دي صورة ازاي؟ يعني انت شفت تاني طبعا وليه كده اللي طالعه بالطرف
لا ما هو المسدس اهو
فين ما هو المسدس في ايده بيأمن نفسه بيه
ايوه
تأمين يعني تحقيق العين هيجن على غضب الله
طب يعني هو نسب تأمين بس والناس اللي وقعوا بس من
مجرد ما فيش حد من القوات المسلحه طلع بره واقسموا على هذا
طب ايه المشكله في ان يكون هناك تحقيقا لن تعرفوا تدريب نار
التحقيق ده قائم
قائم
دلوقتي
طب احنا ليه بنستبق الامور وبننفي تماما
السبب بسيط انا عارف العقيده العسكريه العقيده العسكريه لا يمكن عسكري او ضابط مصري يرفع سلاحه في وجه وفي وجه مصري ساحب
طيب اهو بص يا فندم بص شفت الطلقه الفرع زي المسدس حضرتك وده مش عسكري واضح ان هو رتبه يعني حتى زيه مختلف عن عسكري
انا عايز اقول للشرطه اسمعي انا عايز اقول لحضرتك حاجه انا عايز اقول لحضرتك طب ما في ضغط في الهواء
لا ده مكانش في الهواء ده كان على مستوى
انت شفتيها
نشوفها تاني حضرتك نشوفها تاني
حضرتك في الهواء برضه
اهي بص حضرتك اهي هنشوفها ونشوف في الهواء ازاي ايوه بص حضرتك بص حضرتك
جاي مسدس في
ايدك قدامه ده مش في الهواء
يعني انت حاجة
انا ما شفتش الناحيه الثانيه
حضرتك
بس في قتلة
انت من اول القعده وانت بتركزي على الموت والشهداء والصواف و الى اخره
لا
عايزين ننتقل الى نقط
ولكن هل دي كانت حقائق ولا احنا يعني بنخلقها هل في
Debates about what images show us or what they don't only take place on television, whether secular or religious. They also take place at protests, in cab rides, at weddings, coffee shop gatherings, within family, among friends, and between strangers on street corners. Indeed, much of the talk and divisions about the revolution among Egyptians has come to be mediated through images, in particular the various videos captured by citizens and posted online. These videos have come to stand in for two sorts of parallel realities, one in which the military is clearly a repressive counter-revolutionary force, and one in which it is thugs or baltagaya armed with American dollars and the malicious expertise of Photoshop who are aiming at destabilizing the country. To illustrate some of the textures of these contestations, I would like to go back to Tahrir Square on January 25th, 2012, but this time look outside of the frame of the camera, look outside of Tahrir Square, actually. I was an observer participant that day in two discussions, arguments really, among groups of Egyptians, where the main point of contention was their differing reactions and interpretations of two different videos on YouTube capturing recent events. I'll read the following excerpts from my field notes of that day. A middle-aged man is standing in front of the burnt Egyptian Institute. He's telling the small crowd gathered around him that it was the revolutionaries, the Suwar, who set the building on fire and stopped the firefighters from putting it out. The crowd nods its agreement until a woman in her 30s speaks up. "No, that's not what I saw in the video," she says. The man counters quickly. "I saw the video too, but look, I was here, I was standing here, and I believe my own eyes. Were you here? You weren't here." The woman is not impressed. "Look, in the video, we clearly see the revolutionaries trying to put the fire out." "No, no," the man argues. "It just seemed that way. Those were actually soldiers, but they had to dress in civilian clothing. Otherwise, they would have been attacked by the mob." He turns to the man closest to him, an elderly gentleman. "Are you following my drift, Yahag?" he asks him. "But I didn't see any videos," the man shrugs. "So I don't know what to believe." A second conversation. Near the Semiramis Hotel, just off the square, two middle-aged women are talking to a group of young men passing out stickers that say, "Down with military rule," that were made by Kazibun. "You shouldn't be saying this against the military," one of them says. "They are our family, part of us." "Did you see what they did to the revolutionaries?" one of the men asks. "Are you talking about that girl?" "That girl was not respectable, مش محترمة. She wasn't wearing anything underneath her abaya, cloak. I wear abaya to pray, and you have to wear something underneath. Otherwise, you'll be easily exposed. You probably didn't know this. And she wasn't even wearing a normal bra. She was wearing a nice bikini." "So you think she wanted to get beaten and have her clothes torn off?" the man asks, his voice rising. "Yes," the second woman replies, "because this is all play acting, tamthil. She was planted there to make the military look bad, so that someone would take that photo of her and show it to the world, so that Egypt would be embarrassed." The young men start to walk away in seeming disgust. "Open your eyes, you're all in denial," one of them shouts over his shoulder. So I want to explore further these sorts of everyday contestations about seeing and its ethical and political ramifications. But first, I want to make a slight sort of detour and briefly point to a sort of prehistory of citizen use of media, because we often talk about the revolution as always enacting something new, when actually there's a well-documented history of activist use of images and image-making technologies prior to the revolution. One example is the Shayfinkum campaign, which translates into "We See You," which was started in 2005 by tireless political activists and potential presidential candidate Buthaina Kamel. And the Shayfinkum activists videotaped instances of ballot stuffing and voter intimidation in that year's parliamentary election, and then posted them online on their website and on YouTube. A second important example from the immediate pre-revolutionary period is the use of personal blogs to publicize incidents of police brutality. Wael Abbas's blog, Al-Wa'i al-Masri, or The Egyptian Conscience, became the most important internet forum for this, with sort of dozens of videos uploaded, most of them shot on cell phone cameras, sometimes by other police officers who were participating in the torture and abuse going on. And these videos would often go viral and find a secondary circulation on Facebook and YouTube, and then a tertiary one in opposition newspapers, which began to systematically cover incidents of police brutality. The idea behind both of these initiatives was to subject government corruption and violence to a public gaze, to make them visible to ordinary citizens, but also, more importantly, to let the regime see that it was being seen, that it was sort of impossible to assume that its actions will remain invisible or covert to others. And so the camera was a weapon against state violence in the sense that the images it produced, sort of physical perceptible evidence of the oppressive nature of the regime was used to counter the official narrative of Egypt as a democracy where these things don't happen. The online communities within which the images produced circulated came to be seen by many as an alternative public sphere, one free of government censorship, a space of speaking, showing truth to power, of making visible the violence of the state against ordinary citizens. And I think the materiality of the medium used here, right, the cell phone camera, is important because it speaks to a personal witnessing, the blurry, jerky images, the street noise that often intrudes, the lack of tripod or professional production values. All of these contribute to the authenticity and credibility of the images shot, protecting them from charges of fabrication. So to sort of fast forward, during the 18 days leading up to Mubarak's resignation, citizen media activism and the online spaces which make it possible did two important things. First, they publicized the fact that there were a large number of people in the street and that those people were peaceful, and two, that these peaceful protesters were being met with violence. And big television networks like Al Jazeera Arabiya, CNN, BBC relied prominently on these amateur videos in their coverage of events and asked sort of viewers to send them in. After Mubarak stepped down and the military assumed power, there were several media activism initiatives. Musirin and its Askar Kazibun is one of the most prominent. Musirin, which is a play on the Arabic word for Egyptians, Masriyin, and the word for insistence, so they say we insist on the revolution, underscores the important role played by citizen-generated images in the revolution, as this quote from its website shows. Musirin activists and media makers describe themselves as the propaganda machine of the revolution. We do not claim to represent all points of view, but the point of view of the revolution, one of them says in an interview. We are the voice of the voiceless. So while Musirin produces a variety of videos, I would like to focus on its Askar Kazibun campaign. The campaign takes its name from the headline of Tahrir newspaper, an opposition newspaper that was launched after the revolution, the day after the attack on the Blue Bra girl, and after that infamous press conference where the military denied attacking her or shooting at protesters. And this denial was repeated in various venues, as the clip I screened shows. So the main medium for Kazibun's exposé is the projection of a compilation of videos, most of them taken by ordinary people on their cell phones, some shot by Musirin activists themselves, that show military violence. And they sort of use portable video projectors and makeshift screens and show these videos in different public squares and streets, both in Cairo and in the provinces, and it has sort of become internationalized. There was a Kazibun screening in New York, there was one in London and Toronto and DC, and so on. The campaign frames itself as an alternative source of information to state media, symbolized by Maspero, the building that Viola showed us, which houses the sort of the state broadcasting sector, and which has largely refrained from criticizing SCAF and is seen by revolutionaries as a mouthpiece of power rather than a people. Just as Maspero targets every home, so do they, one Musirin activist put it to me in an interview. And he said that a very important moment for the campaign, one that Viola also mentioned, came when they actually screened one of their videos against the very walls of Maspero, with the protesters below chanting, "Here are the liars, here are the liars." So according to some of the founding members of this campaign, which remains a largely decentralized project with Facebook as its main sort of organizational base, and all the videos are available in different resolutions for downloading and projecting, activists were tired of preaching to the choir in Tahrir and decided to take what they had experienced out of the square and out of the online world, as they put it, into the public in the hope of shocking them, nizdimhum, this is their phrasing, out of their preconceived notions of what the military is capable or incapable of doing. For Kazibun, the so-called silent majority is silent because it is simply unaware of SCAF brutality. These Egyptians, the logic goes, have only to see such brutality with their own eyes. It has only to be made visible to them for them to join the other Egyptians calling for the removal of the military regime. In an interview, one of the organizers puts it like this. He says, "Our videos reply to everything SCAF says with realities, with images. We just project these images and let people decide. Indeed, the image is the most truthful response, azdaq rad, to all that the generals have said on state television." So I've attended a few Kezibun screenings in different parts of Cairo, and usually after the screening is very short, it's around 6 minutes, there's a march that takes place in the vicinity, that calling for the downfall of the military council. And contrary to the hopes of organizers for letting the images speak for themselves, many times they provide a sort of live running commentary on the videos, pointing out different key moments and or explaining what's going on. And more importantly, contrary to their hopes of moving people through moving images, many times they're attacked by viewers after the screenings and labeled as traitors. So I would like to now show a short clip from one of the first videos that Oscar Kezibun produced.
قصف طوب متصل وهالة وشتائم بأفظع أفظع مما يتصوره بشر. المسلسل اللي انا ذكرتكم بيه بتاع ماس بيرو وبتاع محمد محمود وبتاع ادي شارع نفس الطريقه الممنهجه هناك فرق بين متظاهر طاهر عنده مطلب بيعرضه وبين انسان بيخرب ويحرق الدوله الظروف اللي وقعت فيها ايه اللي حصل في ما تجيش اللقطه دي بس وتسجلي بيه ده انت او غيرك تسجلي من ده على ان دي تدللي بيها على ان استخدامهم شوف الظروف كلها
So this strategy of juxtaposing words and images was deliberately adopted by Kezibun as the most effective way to persuade potential viewers of SCAF duplicity. We don't need words to counter them, one of the organizers told me, because we have images. We believe images have power, that we can use images to change things. So I'll now like to show another clip from a video report made by the Egyptian newspaper Al Masri Youm, which interviews some viewers after a Kezibun screening.
اللقطه بتاعت البنت وهي بتتضرب وتتسحل من ثلاث عساكر
جيش دي وان ده مش بروجرام او اجندات خارجيه او اجندات من هنا اهو او الجمعيات اللي واخده تمويل من امريكا ومن دول ثانيه كتيره واللي النهارده النيابه عماله تلمها
حضرتك مش معترض على اللقطه دي
انا مش معترض على اي حاجه احنا بنبني دوله جديده
واحده ماشيه في نص الشارع ماشيه لابسه بنطلون ومش لابسه حاجه تحتها هو الجيش اللي سطرها انت حضرتك شفتها انت حضرتك شفتها
حضرتك اللي صور اللقطه دي زميلي اسمه احمد المصري في المصري
ماشي الجيش اللي سطر البنت دي هي وهي بتجري راحت وقع اما وقعت الجيش جري عليها عشان يقومها فاثناء ما قومها طبعا عبايتها الكباتين راحت مفتوحه فهو طبعا بيشيلها فراحت مصورها لانها بنت فراح هو سطرها الجيش يا بابا ما تقولش على الجيش اللي هو ضرب اهالي
So as I mentioned, Kezibun operates on the assumption that the image is self-evident, self-explanatory. It has only to be seen to be believed. But what happens when the image is greeted with disbelief or worse, indifference? As countless theorists of visual culture have shown, meanings are not inherent in images. People will often see an image differently from how it was intended to be seen, bringing to their viewing experiences their own social orientations, prior experiences, and preformed ideas about the reality the image seeks to make visible. For example, many of the ordinary Egyptians who are the target audience of these images believe that they are photoshopped, a word that entered the popular lexicon, ironically, when Al-Ahram newspaper photoshopped this picture to show Mubarak at the lead of these leaders in 2010. Or they believe that the videos are staged, or that they show events that are taking place in Syria, Yemen, Bahrain, but not in Egypt. Here, as William Mitchell wrote a decade ago, the truth claims of images clash with their technological possibilities of manipulation. In interviews, Kazibun and Mosorin activists give different explanations for this reaction, ranging from an omnipresent revolution fatigue among ordinary citizens to a general state of moral hypocrisy, where to pretend not to see or not to believe has become the default position, to more essentialist explanations that see Egyptians supporting those in power as enacting a slave mentality inherited from pharaonic times, a mentality made visible by their veneration of the image of their oppressors. The most pervasive reason given, however, for the frequent failure of images to perform as intended is the hegemonic force of the official narrative as propagated through state media. Activists often cite the statistic that only 20% of Egyptians have access to the internet, making offline media their main source of information. Within this analysis, the operative assumption is that those supporting the military or those who have come to see the revolutionaries as thugs, baltagaya, are mudallalin, or brainwashed, because they are outside of the networks of decentralized media that have been key to documenting military violence. Since they are outside of these technology circuits, they're easy prey to spurious claims that the videos and images showing military violence are fabricated. Hence the need, of course, to move images from online to the street in the first place. And all these cartoons and photos are from Kazibun's Facebook page. But the reality is more complicated than that. It's not that those Egyptians lack the requisite skills and social and technological capital to see. They just see differently. Indeed, much of the contestations of anti-military images and rhetoric take place within the same spaces of citizen media activism, online sites such as Facebook and YouTube, and street screenings, and deploy the same weapon, images, with the strategy being to answer images with other images. Their credibility among Egyptians does not come from state media, but precisely from their use of the very alternative sphere of information that worked to discredit this media during the revolution, and for the same reason, that such media is not showing the truth and is not giving voice to the voiceless, in this case, the silent majority. So I would like to now show a brief excerpt from a campaign called Know Your Enemy, اعرف عدوك, which was made by pro-military activists, and they screened it in various public squares in Cairo. I'm running out of time, so I'm going to fast forward. So to research my talk today, I joined a handful of Facebook pages that either support President, former President Mubarak, support the military, or are against fake revolutionaries bent on destroying the country, to be distinguished, of course, from the re-revolutionaries who are all dead. And these pages range in membership from just 200 to over 100,000 in some cases. And my very cursory study of these sites reveals that their use of images can be grouped under three main categories. The first category are images which show the military, usually high-ranking generals, actually helping protesters, wiping away tears, blood, quenching their thirst. These images of the army as the guardian of the revolutionaries have also found their way offline, as they have been put up on billboards on various highways in Cairo. Within this category, there are also images which seek to show the military in a positive light by using a comparative approach. So they either compare sort of the modest lifestyle of the average soldier against the dissolute and conspicuous consumption of elite urban activists, or they put up images of police actions, you know, here in New York or in Greece, to highlight sort of the moral hypocrisy of these countries condemning Egypt's own security forces. The second category are images which question the authenticity of the images put up by anti-military groups. The Blue Bra Girl is a favorite here, with many images sort of devoted to a detailed visual analysis of different parts. Like, so if here, for example, they're highlighting how the soldier is wearing non-military issued sneakers, therefore, you know, and then they're showing how military gear is readily available to protesters themselves. Other times, you know, they say this image was put up by April 6, and they say it was actually cropped, and it was actually taking place in Morocco, not in Egypt. Other times, users put up images side by side to highlight how they were manipulated to show the military in a bad light, when in fact they're a testament to the military's good behavior. Other images within this category don't question so much the accuracy of what is depicted, but rather question the accuracy of how is it framed. Are these protesters really peaceful? Do they really not have weapons? Are they really revolutionaries, or are they simply thugs? The third and final category, by far the largest, consists of personal attacks on prominent activists, most of them associated with the April 6th movement. These attacks often focus on the participation of women protesters and activists, showing them engaging in culturally illicit activities such as smoking hashish joints or cigarettes, or crossing gendered moral lines by interacting freely with male protesters, whether in sit-ins or even in prayer. Such images are often misogynistic and homophobic, with captions framing such activists as immoral and hence not authentic Egyptians, but rather westernized youth seeking to impose a foreign agenda on the rest of society. Mimicking the Kaziboun mantra, many of the captions of these images simply say, "Shahid al-sura wa ahkum binafsak," see the picture and judge for yourself. And I'm just one final thought. While my presentation today has been about images, to an extent, images don't really matter in and of themselves. Rather, as we have seen, they become a catalyst for political contestations where the main question is not what we see, but how we should act and why. And for me, the larger point that emerges from looking at the visual politics of the Egyptian revolution is that we cannot understand what's going on right now in not only in Egypt, but also in Syria, Bahrain, or Libya, for example, without comprehending the range of support for both the opposition and for the regimes in power. Many of us who watched, for example, Barbara Walters' interview with the Syrian President Hafez al-Assad couldn't comprehend his blindness to the state murder of Syrian citizens, and we found him ludicrous. However, there are plenty of people who support Assad and believe him and fight for him. And the same was true for Libya, actually, except that in public discourses, mercenaries came to stand in for the citizen militias that were supporting Gaddafi. And so trying to understand how and why this is so demands that we sit still for a while with images and think more critically about the ways in which they cut both ways in the public sphere. Why is visual evidence of violence, abuse, and torture seen as evidence by some and not by others? And how can we make critical sense of these differing reactions, of these moments when images don't move without sort of lapsing into easy and convenient explanations of the resistance to moving images as an inability to see, as a failure of vision?
Interesting and really informative talks. And I hadn't seen actually a lot of those images myself, so it was great to see it all in relationship to each other. I have one or two questions. Well, I'll start with one question to sort of get us going. And I think both of you actually touched on this, so it would be great for either of you to start responding to this. So much of what you talked about seemed to be about representation, perspective, and there were these two geographical spaces of Tahrir and Spiro that we kept returning to. And I was particularly struck by this idea of projecting onto the Spiro in contrast to looking down onto Tahrir. And so I was wondering if you see some sort of shift or change in the way in which representation of the revolution is now happening, or the questions of perspective of the revolution as we see a shift from the Medin and its centralization to either Mespiro or other spaces and a more decentralizing of the space where the revolution is seen to happen.
Well, actually, parts of your question is actually related to the, to the dispersion actually that is happening, or to the I spoke of the euphoria of the first days, and of course the images in the first 2 months were still a very unified image, and of course the situation. I brought up the idea of counter-revolution. There is a counter-revolution going on, and there are a lot of obstacles and enemies, actually, people who really don't want the revolution to continue and to happen. And this brought about, of course, also different. If I speak of the, you know, the issue of Maspiro, I think it's a very crucial one. That there were people who were against setting up a new place at Maspiro for Coptic protest. I think this was a very important issue, that they allowed themselves to do it was a very crucial problem. A very crucial problem for the revolution itself. In terms of representation, we have also a problem that the revolution was hijacked by official media, mm-hmm. and it got idealized, and of course then there remained the image of the Tahrir in official media as, you know, the image of the nation and of the successful revolution, while in the background everyone was working actually against that image and trying to bring it down. And so Maspiro is, in my view, one of the steps to bring, you know, that to bring it down. And there are, and the dispersal is certainly also going on. But on the other hand, I think that Kazibun and this idea of reversing the image and, you know, now putting the projection on the, is actually also a healthy process, in the sense that now the work begins. I mean, okay, the agora is a nice thing; it was very mobilizing, but you know, we all saw that actually we were deceived, that it didn't work out because we didn't really analyze what is behind all the scene. We didn't know that actually there was an agreement to bring President Mubarak down beforehand, and so. Now the real work begins. So I think it's as problematic as it is, it's also positive for me. Okay.
Well, of course, the revolution was always taking place outside of Tahrir. I think the conflation of Tahrir and the revolution is the result of a specific kind of representation. And I think we always tend or like to forget that even at the height of the uprising, only a minority of Egyptians actually went to Tahrir. And those who sat at home, who are sometimes derisively referred to as Hizb al-Kanada, the party of the couch, their reactions to the uprising were very contingent. It was sometimes it was unanimous support, but other times there was a lot of, well, he promised this and that, so why don't we just, you know, give the guy a break and so on. So this is what I felt like for my interviews. Like, yeah, this is the revolution in a way. And I think the same would go for the counter activists to them. I mean, the interesting thing about the counter activists is that they don't define themselves as counter revolutionaries. They just, as more real revolutionaries, more authentic revolutionaries. So there's all this fight and contestation. It's become a very contested concept, right? The revolution in Egypt. And everybody wants to claim it in their own way.
I mean, I feel like it's contested, yet it's also completely neutralized as a term, right? Mm-hmm. Because everybody supports the revolution.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's just what that actually means. It's sort of become emptied of. I mean, people seem very comfortable in one sentence celebrating the revolution, but also discrediting the 6th of April movement and anybody affiliated with it, because it's the revolution has been emptied of its. It signifies for that. Like, it's just sort of an empty signifier. So I mean, that's interesting. But I was also particularly interested in this. When you said they're actually making the revolution, I thought that was interesting, particularly in this change of perspective of the camera sort of up onto the bill, like actually taking it from here as opposed to taking the image down from exactly. But I mean, I'm sure people have other comments or questions.
I have two, actually, one for Yasmin and the other for Viola. I guess I'll start with Yasmin. I want to pose a kind of an alternative explanation to why people kind of see these images in so many different ways. And, besides, kind of the purposeful political manipulation of them, there's also, I feel like, a cultural explanation. I'm Egyptian. My mom would never think I would do anything wrong. She'd be like, Nayum, And every family in Egypt, if they have more than two sons, there's a mandatory draft. I have cousins that are in the military now. And even after Maspero, he got drafted after that. And my aunt would never believe that he would do something like that or be involved in anything related to that. Also, there's the dynamic between the parent and the son. A lot of people saw Mubarak as the father of the nation. It was almost as if, instead of seeing it as dictatorial politics, it was like patriarchal. It was like trust in, the head of the family, sort of. And I see that as, to some extent, one explanation for why Egyptians tend to see things this way. They were, it's somewhat cultural. And I don't know if that's in opposition to, the fact that the military obviously purposely distorts these images and explains it in their own way, or if they're just playing off of that. The fact that they know that a lot of Egyptians, want to trust in, the male head, and, the mothers don't ever want to accuse their sons of anything. Because literally the military is made up of their sons. So, I wonder what you think about, this cultural element to it that you can see very clearly in Egyptian families. I can't question it yet. And my mom thinks I'm innocent of everything, so.
I don't know. I mean, I guess I would have to think more about that. I think it's a lot of these videos are not made. Like the campaign I showed, the Know Your Enemy, it's made by ordinary people.
Yeah.
So there's, just like the Kazibun, there are these people who just see the situation very differently than the pro-democracy activists. And, sometimes some of them, it's not so much that they support the military, but rather they support the timetable the military has set for the transfer of power. I've been doing research at an Islamic television channel, which is very diverse in its political orientations. We have a lot of brotherhood, some liberals, some Salafis, and so on, and a lot of, but on the whole, they tend to be pro timetable that the military has set, and a lot of them tell me, well, if we have presidential elections in June and the military does not step down, we know where Tahrir Square is and we will go there. But in the meantime, they feel it's sort of secular liberal forces trying to hijack the revolution because the Islamists are now in power, and this is all a game on their part. So I would sort of be wary of explanations that only see the military as generating this kind of media, when in fact a lot of people who don't have stakes in the military as such are also doing it.
Can I ask my other question?
I need to intervene a little bit because we're technically over time, but I'm wondering if I can collect three questions that we can pose collectively and ask both panelists to respond. Since you already had one, are there other folks in the room with questions, or am I just cutting them off for no reason? I guess you get to ask your question.
Okay.
I just like hearing myself talk.
All right. Okay. I'm going to gather my thoughts. So I'm also Coptic. And you were talking about how, you know, this image of the cross and the crescent and how powerful it is, but how it could, to one extent, be seen as, you know, sort of a unity thing, but at the same time, it's emphasizing that there are Copts and Muslims and they have their differences. And I want to ask, moving forward, what do you think the role of the church leadership is in emphasizing one or the other? Because it's just the fact that the vast majority of Copts identify most with their Christian identity, especially, you know, given the you know, the kind of the persecution discourse given the spear and whatnot. And I'm just curious, we saw Father Filibertier kind of spurring them on there, and we know that Pope Shenouda has been an ardent supporter of Mubarak. And I mean, until the very end. And there were political reasons why, I know. But for one reason or the other, do you think the church leadership will be leading the Copts in, you know, towards, you know, more unified and more of the kind of persecution discourse? Or?
Well, I think the persecution discourse is simply very, very dangerous. And this is, I mean, it's in part, of course, in defense to what has happened before. Therefore, I was trying to open up a little bit this historical part that the resurgence of the martyr era was, you know, proclaimed in the 1990s, that, you know, the Coptic community had retreated so much back into the church and into their community that they saw themselves, you know, in a new era of martyrdom because of all the assaults. And so I think, you know, that the development was very negative in that sense. And church and the Pope is simply an old patriarch. And so, of course, you know, there are a lot of similarities between him and Mubarak and the way how he deals, you know, and the whole, whole leadership of the church, how they deal actually with matters. And, you know, they are misogyne even in the personal law status, you know, they went back to, you know, like 50 years to things that are, you know, like 50 years ago, curtailing the personal status and so on. So I try to highlight also the priests. Filopatia, he's one of the priests who was involved. But I try to highlight it also in a critical way because they worked towards, I mean, they are actually also responsible for the massacre of Maspero. I mean, they were blamed for it, but in fact, you know, by the military in a trying to accuse the Copts of being, you know, trying to kind of reverse the status of the culprit with the victim, which is an evil thing. But at the same time, you know, the leadership did also a lot contributed towards, you know, creating that massacre because they actually excluded, they excluded the Copts from, you know, the body of the protesters. So I think this is a real mistake. But at the same time, I see also, you know, positive. I think that what the revolution did at the same time is that the Coptic community got mobilized. They went to the streets, something that they would not have done before. The first large demonstration was actually after the attack on Alexandria in January 1st. So this was the prelude. A big demonstration started the days after. And so this mobilization is also positive because that means, you know, we go back to becoming a political subject. And we express ourselves, we defend our rights. There will be a larger movement of, you know, that includes all citizens. And there is a revolutionary movement that is going on, and I mean that is creating the image of Mina Daniel and Khaled Said together, and I think they will hopefully even surpass this binary image towards a real diverse image. And there is, I mean, we have seen that, and some of the groups like Kazibun and Mosavin are, you know, they believe in the diversity and they represent it in what they are. So I can see, you know, that there will be a change definitively, but it will take time.
Okay. I would like to see the women of Tahrir and the four films that were mentioned on yours, Viola. How do we see these? How can we get them?
Mine is available on Vimeo and YouTube. You'll do a search.
Oh, that we made, that's on Make Up Your Mind. If you look,
there are four mentioned on your Lemon Tree.
Oh, my films, they are distributed. You have to go to the Air Film Distributor, or my latest is with Mac Film in Germany. So, yeah, all Arab films in, where is that? There is an Arab film distribution here in the US also where you can find it.
Yeah, that's arabfilm.com.
Yeah, thank you.
On that note, I'm going to choose to end on the earlier comment, the hopeful, I guess, hopeful vision for a diverse revolutionary. And let me thank all of our panelists.